read the words, don't worry. I hear in my head, stop it. You know, like, how? What am I meant to do? In the words of Liam Gallagher, hello, hello, it's good to be back. It's good to be back. Some of you might need to ask your children or grandchildren who Liam Gallagher is. It's a tricky time to be back, though, isn't it? For a while, we've been hearing talk of a cost of living crisis. We've watched as the price of food has steadily gone up and up. Petrol. I can't believe Adrian and I drove past the BP garage the other day, and it was £1.78 or something for diesel. We both looked at each other and went, oh, that's cheap. It's not cheap. It's ridiculous. But at least it's not £2 a gallon like it was a couple of months ago. We've all heard the news that the church energy bills are about to skyrocket. And we're wondering how on earth we're going to afford to pay the bills and keep the church doors open and be a place of welcome for the community. Because let's face it, no one feels welcome if they're sitting there in an icebox, do they? Worries. And they don't end there, do they? Adrian and I have just come back from a few weeks staying out in East Anglia, where we've taken the opportunity to visit all of our family, our sons, who are themselves worrying about how they're going to pay their own bills, how they're going to afford to get to work, how they're going to heat their homes and feed themselves. And we took the opportunity to visit our respective parents and step-parents, and they're all getting increasingly elderly. And health problems are rising, and pensions just don't go as far as they used to, do they? It's such a worry. Add to that all the worries we have about Adrian. For those of you that don't know, on Friday, Adrian had to go for a routine blood test, ready for one of his regular kidney appointments next week. Later on Friday afternoon, the phone rang. Please come straight to hospital. Please don't drive yourself. Your potassium level is so high, your heart could stop at any moment. It was a kind of go directly to hospital, don't pass, go, don't pass, don't collect £200 kind of telephone call. And Adrian ended up in hospital all night on a drip. And they were convinced at one point that he'd had a heart attack. Thankfully, praise Jesus, he hadn't. But you know, it's worrying. You get a call like that, you start to worry. You'd be stupid. There'd be something wrong with you if you didn't start to worry. So this passage then cannot be saying that it's wrong to worry. Neither is it saying that as a Christian, you will never, ever have anything to worry about. I've just listed to you just a really small fraction of the stuff that we're dealing with and worrying about right now. And I know that you will have your own worries, things that just tick over and over and over in your mind. We all have things and people and situations in our lives that we're worried about right now. But it doesn't end at our doorstep, does it? In the wider world as well, you know, I've given up opening the newspapers and turning on the TV. I've genuinely, if there's not cricket or football on the telly now, my telly don't go on, because I can't stand the constant barrage of bad news, the war in Ukraine, floods in Pakistan, and everything that's going on closer to home. We turned the TV on for the first time in about 3 weeks on a particular Thursday morning, because we do like a bit of bargain hunt. Okay, I'm letting you into all of our secrets now. We do like a bit of bargain hunt to have our lunch too, don't we, sweetheart? And we turned bargain hunt on, and then they stopped bargain hunt to tell us that the Queen was desperately ill. That was the first time we'd turned the TV on in about 3 weeks. So much is changing in our world. So much is in transition right now. We are in a national period of mourning for our Queen. We now have a King. We have a new Prime Minister. Does anyone have a clue what her new policies are going to be? Does anyone have a clue if she's going to be better or worse than the last one? Does anyone have a clue if she's got any way of tackling the cost of living crisis and the energy crisis that we face right now? There is no one who is immune from worry. And the thing is, when we come to this passage, and if we kind of read it just in isolation on its own like we have today, it can feel a bit like that clip we just watched, can't it? You know, I'm worried about paying my bills. Stop it. I'm worried about my children. Stop it. I'm worried about my increasingly aging relatives. Stop it. I'm worried about the poor people in society who already have nothing and now will have even less. Stop it. It can feel a bit like that, can't it? Or there's that song. Who remembers that song? Most of you that know me now, Live My Life. There's a constant song going through my head of one or another. And if you're with me long enough, it will come out of my mouth. Poor old Sue in the office gets serenaded half a dozen times every day. What's that song? Don't worry, be happy. As if it was so easy. Don't worry, be happy. But Jesus knows what our life is like. He knows we will face trouble and worries and anxieties and all sorts of problems. He is not saying, stop it. Look at verse 34. Look at verse 34. Jesus says, don't worry about tomorrow, because each day has enough worries of its own. In other words, don't chase after the worries that haven't got here yet, because you've got enough to deal with today. Just deal with today's worries. So having said what the passage doesn't say, let's have a look together at what it does say. It starts off, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink or what you will wear. So these words, Jesus is standing on a hillside speaking to ordinary Jewish people, people who have found that their day-to-day life is actually getting more and more and more difficult. The Romans are encroaching more and more on their daily lives, taking more and more of their land and their livelihoods. The rich are getting richer, the poor are getting poorer. And the ordinary people have to pay taxes to Rome, which, depending on the integrity or not of the tax collector, could be pretty high. And so Jesus is talking to ordinary people when he says these words. And these would be ordinary people who either make their living from the land or from the sea. In other words, they were reliant on the harvest being successful, on the crops providing a good yield, enough for them to eat for themselves and some left over, for them to sell, to make a bit of money, to buy the other necessities. Or in the same way, being able to catch enough fish to cook for themselves and to sell to others. Theirs would have been a very hand-to-mouth existence, in a way that ours isn't, in a way that we struggle sometimes to understand. And they wouldn't have had wardrobes full of different outfits. They would have had one winter cloak for when it got cold, and for the poorest, that would have doubled as their cover, their blanket for them, for when they slept. So for them, for these people that Jesus is talking to, there really was a worry about what they were going to eat, what they were going to be able to feed their families, what they were going to wear. Would they be able to feed themselves and keep themselves and their families warm? And Jesus says to them, if you're focusing on the problem, if you're focusing on the food and on the blanket or the clothes, you're focusing on the wrong thing. Instead of focusing on the problem, focus on God. Because he says your heavenly Father knows that you need these things. And this is where we get to trust. All of our songs, I don't know, I almost feel like I should play that game, you know, what the link that goes through all of the songs. This isn't just thrown together, these services, you know. Jan and I spend hours trying to go through and choose the best songs. And the theme through all of them today has been trust. Trust in God. God is enough. But it's easy to trust, isn't it, when things are going great? It's easy to trust God with our money when the bank account's looking really healthy. It's easy to trust God with my children when they're all well and happy and healthy and settled. It's harder to trust when things start to wobble. because my natural instinct is to want to come in and sort things out. I'll get things back on an even keel, and then I'll trust God again. And that can't be just me, can it? We want to get things straight and sorted so that we again can start to trust God once things are okay again. We'll sort out our bank account right now, God. We'll sort out our gas and our electric and all of the things that we want to do. And then once we've got everything sorted out, God, then we'll trust you again. The challenge is to trust God in the middle of the situation, whatever it is that you need. Your Heavenly Father knows that you need them. God knows we need to pay the gas and electric bills. God knows we need to fix the front doors and the windows to keep the building secure and weatherproof. God knows that some of us, possibly for the first time in a long time, are planning not to turn the heating on this winter. Instead, we're planning on managing with hot water bottles and blankets to get through the cold days, because pensions just don't stretch as far as they used to. And at the same time as energy prices have gone up, so has food, so has petrol, so has everything that we need to live, it seems. God knows you need these things. And instead of worrying, Jesus says, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. There's a song, I'm full of songs. I used to sing it at school. Did anybody else used to sing it? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And it used to go off, didn't it? Hallelujah. We'll not go there. Instead of worrying, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. In other words, lift your eyes, lift your thinking, lift the focus. What are you focusing on? Are you focusing on the problem, or are you focusing on Jesus? I've got another song going through my head now. It's going to have to come out. Lift your eyes. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will go strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Isn't that true, though? When we take our eyes off the problem, when the problem stops being the biggest thing and Jesus becomes the biggest thing, God knows you need these things. So when you find yourself with something to worry about, we don't have to look very hard, most of us, do we? We find things to worry about. Oh, there's something else just there. Wonderful. We don't have to look very hard. But when you find yourself with something to worry about, change your focus. Lift your eyes from your circumstances and from your problem, and instead focus on Jesus. Seek first his kingdom and trust that he knows what you need. And he's given us all of the tools that we need. He isn't just saying to us, oh, don't worry, it will be fine. He's given us a toolkit. So I want you now to open your Bibles up to our passage. It was in Matthew chapter 6, but it isn't sitting there in a vacuum. It is part of the whole of the Sermon on the Mount. And if we just look at the beginning of the chapter, if we just look at chapter 6, we can see that God has given us all of the tools. I deliberately asked Eileen to start reading a verse earlier than we usually would today, because why on earth would you start a passage with therefore? It's a linking word, isn't it? Therefore is a linking word. It's like Jesus is saying, here's all the stuff that I'm teaching you prior to this. Therefore, based on what I've just told you, don't worry. So we need to look earlier in the chapter. It's like Jesus is saying, instead of wasting your time worrying, this is what you should do. This is how you seek first the kingdom of God And the first thing we find in the chapter, giving to the needy. Church. We are a small church with a big heart. We always have been. We punch well above our weight when it comes to things like shoeboxes, when it comes to things like food bank, when it comes to harvest, when it comes to things. If I put an appeal out, you give. You are a hugely generous people. Don't let worry about finances rob you of your generous spirit. Don't let worry about the bank rob you of that gift of generosity that you have. That's so significant right now because the cost of living crisis is hitting everyone. As I said, some of us here will have to tighten our belts and, you know, just turn the thermostat down a notch or two or put an extra jumper on or something. Others here will have to make a choice between heating and eating. In our street, in our neighbourhood, parents will go without so that their children can eat. People will die this winter from lack of food and lack of heating. And the challenge for us, as we try to seek first the kingdom of God within this situation, is to trust God with our giving, to give to the needy, and to trust God that he knows what I need, what we need. I've always had this thing. I got a picture years and years and years ago. It's always stayed with me. See, what happens is we're a generous people and we hold our hand like this. But what usually happens when we start to feel the pinch and we have no money is we tighten our grip around what we have in order to try and hold on to it. But then that blocks our generosity from flowing out. More importantly, it blocks God's blessings from flowing in. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness by giving to the needy. Then it takes your focus off the money that you don't have to the God who knows you need these things. That's a challenge, isn't it? To give generously when it means that you might have to go without in order to do so instead of giving out of your surplus. Don't let worry about money rob you of your generous spirit. Trust the God who knows you need these things. Okay, as we carry on reading down chapter 6, what else? What comes next? Well, next comes prayer. Crumbs, I could do a whole series on the Lord's Prayer and all that it means, line by line, and still not exhaust it. But the point that I want to make to us today is instead of worrying and fretting and getting all het up and all tied up in knots, pray. Pray. When you feel anxiety rising, pray. It was wonderful on Friday night and Saturday morning to know that Adrian and I were being held in prayer, to know that our family and friends that we'd managed to get the word out to were praying for us, to know the presence of God in the middle of our anxiety was wonderful. Pray. Seek first the kingdom of God through prayer. We've got a half night of prayer coming up on Friday. We need, as a church, to gather together, to pray together. You know, sometimes we've called half nights of prayer and people have gone, oh, I might go if I'm not busy. Church, this is a call to prayer. We are in anxious times. There are huge, momentous decisions ahead. We need to come together as a church to pray, to lift our eyes and our hearts to God. And then following the half night of prayer, we're going to introduce a regular monthly, once a month, day of prayer and fasting. We won't always gather to pray, But Jenny and I will arrange some dates and we will send them out to you. And the idea is that you join with us wherever you are, at home or away, in fasting and praying, either on your own or with your regular triplet or whoever or whatever. Instead of worrying about what is ahead, we're going to pray and we're going to fast. Because that's what the next bit that Jesus goes on to in chapter 6, isn't it? Fasting. Traditionally, fasting is going without food for a period of time. For some of us, that'll be a morning or an afternoon or a full day. I don't know about you. I pray all the time, constantly. Poor old Jesus must get sick of hearing me yattering on to him. It's like a constant going up and down in my head. But you know, I only pray when I only fast when the going gets tough. I'm embarrassed to admit it, church. Pray all the time, fast occasionally. Jesus knows I'm serious when I fast. You know it's that rare. So, church, this is a time for prayer and fasting. This is a time for seeking God as we go forward. That we will together seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. But church, we need to trust the God who knows what we need. He has brought us through over 180 years of history, hasn't he? Of highs and lows, of ups and downs. And he has plans and a purpose for us still. The challenge for us as we go forward from here is who or what will dictate the plans and purpose of this church? Will it be God who sets our plans and our purpose and our program and all of the things and the outreach and all of the things we do? Or will it be the energy bills? Will we allow God to lead us forward? Or will we be led by the numbers on the bank balance? Because it's easy to trust when everything's rosy, isn't it? The challenge is to trust that God knows what we need when things are not so rosy. So church, I've got a challenge for you. We all have stories of God's faithfulness to us. We all have stories of how God has brought us through. We all have stories about the life of our church and our own personal testimonies of how God has brought us through. Let's remind ourselves and tell ourselves the stories of God's faithfulness to us in the past. The promises that God has made to us, the things he has said, the things he has done. Let's remember who he is and what he has done. The stories of who God is and what he has done for us individually as a church and as a church. Tell one another those stories. Encourage one another with how great is our God. Because that's what the people in the Bible do, isn't it? All the way through the Bible, the people remind themselves what God has done for them. How many times are you reading a passage in the Bible and it says, remember when God led us through the sea? Remember when God brought us out of slavery? Remember when God led us through the wilderness and provided everything we need? Remember when we were in exile and God brought us home rejoicing? They remind themselves again and again and again of what God has done. Church, we need to do the same because we've all got stories, incredible stories of what God has done and how we come to be here in this place right now. Let's share those stories and encourage one another because our God is a faithful God. He is a good God and he knows what we need. And all we have to do is not waste energy and time and waste our focus on worrying about things that we have no control over. Rather, we lift our eyes and our focus to God. As the saying goes, we might not know what the future holds, but we know the one who holds the future. Hallelujah. So we're going to share a story now. The wonderful Anne. It's going to come now. Anne, it's your last Sunday with us. Anne is going back. We're all sad. that Annie's disappearing. Annie's over the moon because she's going back to see her husband and her children. So we're all like, oh, Anne, we'll miss you. And she's like, bye. But Anne's going to come now and she's going to encourage us all with her incredible story of how she came to be here and how God has been with her. So let's be encouraged by all that our awesome God has done and all that he can do as Anne comes up to speak. Yeah, you can come up here, sweetheart, if you want to, and then you can put your paper down. It's all you can do down there. It's up to you. Where would you prefer? Come up here, then it's easier.
I think it's going to be okay. Morning, church. Yeah, I'm very happy to share with you a little about my journey here to the UK and what I've been doing. My name is Anne Nyiransabimana. I'm from Rwanda. I'm married. I have two children, boys. You know, the Bible says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, the plan to prosper you and not to harm you, plan to give you hope and a future." I'm sorry, I'm not preaching, it's just a reminder. Yeah. God has his way to accomplish his plan for everyone. I never thought of pursuing master's courses, but my journey to undertake a master's course has been started with my husband. In 2019, my husband asked me to apply for Commonwealth Scholarship. At that time, I refused. I said, no, I cannot live away from my child for a year. At that time, I had only one child. Few days later, he asked again, "Anne, you are eligible for Commonwealth Scholarship and you are unemployed. I beg you, use wisely the opportunity around you and apply for scholarship. I will look after the child." I said, "No, I cannot do that." And then he asked me a question, "Anne, if you die tonight, who will look after the child?" So it was a big question, difficult question for me to answer. I just kept quiet. You know, the Bible says, love is patient, love is kind. Love does not insist on its own way. Therefore, I finally decided to prepare a project for applying for Commonwealth Scholarship. Few months later, after submitting my application, I became pregnant. So I said, oh, that was not God's plan. However, it was truly God's plan for me to give me happiness, to make my stay in the UK smooth, to allow me grow in knowledge, understanding, and wisdom. Because, you know, if I had to come in 2020, I couldn't meet you. So it was God's plan to give me a chance to meet you. Finally, I have received the confirmation of award, and I sent an email to Commonwealth Commission telling them that I'm pregnant. I couldn't imagine how they can be flexible, but I received a wonderful email telling me that you have to apply for deferment until 2021. That's why I gather with you this morning. On my arrival, everything was unfamiliar for me, with me. It was my first time to be away from my family. It was my first time to be away, to be abroad. I meet with different people from different parts of the world, with different culture. Food was unfamiliar with me. weather, climate, everything was unfamiliar. The night was very painful. They hurt me deeply because the focus was just on my family, especially my children. I was suffering from homesick. But God is good, God is love. From the moment I joined the church, I found rest, I found comfort. I remember the first day I joined the church, you gave me a warm welcome. June, thank you very much. I will not forget. You gave me a wonderful welcome pack. And within the welcome pack, there was two sentences. The first one was, we are a small church with big heart. The second one was, our vision is to share love, hope, and hospitality of Jesus in our church and across the town. Due to the love he showed me at my first time joining you and the wonderful welcome pack, I leave it that this is my place to stay. This is my place to be. That's why I kept coming. You have been my family. You have been my home from home. You were always keen of my academic achievement. I like how you used to ask me, Anne, how are you doing? Anne, how are your children? How is your family? Are you happy with academic? You were always keen about my happy, about my academic achievement. So I like it. God bless you for setting and fulfilling wonderful vision to share the hope, love, and hospitality with people. God bless you for giving me rest and comfort. God bless you for being good disciple. You know, the Bible says, come, you who are weary, I'll give you rest. You will find comfort. So God bless you. You've been good disciples for me. You taught me what unconditional love is. Thank you very much. I will miss you. I learned to be honest. I learned a lot from you. You've been my good teacher. God bless you.
Come back. We need to pray for you, Anne. We have a small gift for you, but come here.